specifically for refugees. And we know of the UNHCR report that has just been released indicating that 4 million refugee children have no access to education. This is worrying, don't you think?
This is indeed worrying. And 4 million, you know, it's not just a figure.
Yeah.
4 million young children who have no access to education, whose lives perhaps will have been destroyed forever, and above all, who live in refugee camps. Now, in the context of the Somalia refugees, we have in this sub-region nearly 1 million Somali refugees who have been in exile for the last 27 years since the collapse of the central government in Somalia in 1991. And a great majority of them are in Kenya, Ethiopia, Djibouti, Uganda, Yemen, and Eritrea. And as you will know, that the Somali refugee situation indeed in itself is a very protracted situation. Essentially, a refugee camp is supposed to be only for an emergency intervention. So when you have a camp that's established for 27 years, and in the case of Kenya now, in Dadaab, we have a camp in Dadaab 27 years and we're still counting. And half of the population in that camp are school-aged going children, half of them. And nearly 60% only have access to basic education, and less than 1% have access to tertiary and university education. So you can see that the crisis in which the refugee children are now globally suffering, 90% of the refugee population around the world is in Africa, and much more in our own sub-region. We have the situation of the Somalis. So it's really quite worrying, and that is why this report we released as UNHCR needs to attract the attention of the global community of host governments so that we can address the challenges of this crisis.
Well, speaking of addressing the challenges of this particular crisis, is it possible to scale down the numbers of the people affected in the Kenya-Somalia holding centers? And perhaps could you also verify the gravity of this particular problem?
Well, first of all, the gravity is, as I told you, 60% of what we now have in Kenya as refugee population, particularly in the Dadaab, half are children of the population, school-going children. Mm-hmm. 60% have access, 40% do not have access at all. And even of that 60%, therefore, it means that we need to do a little more in terms of improving on the quality of the infrastructure we have. Mm-hmm. And while we thank governments like Kenya, and I want to say here that a country like Kenya, in fact, leads within the context of the sub-region in providing quality education to the Somali population. Some of the good stories we have are some of the children born in the camp, educated in the camp, having found education in our universities here in Kenya, ended up becoming members of parliament in Somalia and ministers. Some are directors. So there's a good story to tell. And you see, these people become also ambassadors of the country. They are not Kenyans, but you see, in terms of the education they have received, in terms of attitude, they reflect how a Kenyan should behave. And therefore, in the context of what we are dealing with now in Kenya, I think there is need for the host governments, Kenya, Ethiopia, Djibouti, Uganda, all the host governments, to consider to have an affirmative action in terms of including the refugees in the national program and national activities, because those camps strictly do not come under the purview of the Kenya government. But if they could be included in the national programs and treated like as good as schools we have for the Kenyan children, I'm sure that we can turn the tide in the context of Kenya, and we can even produce more children from the camps to become more qualified. And you know, when they become more qualified, they go back to their country and become helpful. They also become global citizens wherever they go. They could be in Kenya or elsewhere in the world, and become global citizens and work everywhere, anywhere else in the world. So I think there is great opportunity we have here in Kenya, but we need a little bit more to be done for the Somali refugees. And here I also want to mention an aspect I personally established a couple of weeks ago.
Okay.
We did a research even to find out the ones who qualify, who transit from primary to secondary. We have about 1,000 of them who transit almost every year. Mm-hmm. from secondary to the universities. But only 1%, which is about 400, managed to get educational opportunities in the university and vocational training. So we have nearly 1,000 more lying idle in the camps, maturing in the camps, getting frustrated in the camps. The effect of it is they lose hope. Some of them do dangerous migration. They go to Europe and die in the high seas. Others can be recruited by criminal elements. I mean, you have people around us who are looking for young people who can be used to undertake dangerous, you know, activities in Somalia, in Kenya. So I think there is need to address even those who transit from high school, to address the needs of those ones who qualified to go to university education, so that we can be able to heal the society.
Well, that's very true. Speaking of the elements that might actually come and try and turn the tidings, especially in terms of security matters, we've seen the Kenyan government last year and also early this year really push for the closure of Dadaab refugee camp. What's your take on that?
You know, first of all, I would like to thank the Kenya government myself and the Kenyan people. It's not easy to host refugees for 27 years and to continue to count. So that generosity, that hospitality, I think all of us need to appreciate and thank. The refugees also do thank that hospitality. Now, once the government decided to have a decision to close down, we had a conversation with the Kenya government, and I want to thank the president for leading efforts to find a durable solution. Now the conversation was, how do we find a durable solution to the Somali refugee crisis? And Kenya was generous enough to host a regional summit here in Nairobi in March 2017, which came out with a blueprint, because closure is not a solution. We will require a durable solution to the refugee situation, not only in Kenya, but also in Ethiopia, in Djibouti. As you know, Somalia is still struggling. Peace efforts there are on course, but very slow. The conditions in the country is not such that it can carry massive return of its population because of the infrastructure inside Somalia, because of the security situation inside Somalia. So there's no possibility of the 1 million Somalis in the sub-region going back one time to the country. So the president was kind enough to host this conversation. And here in Nairobi, under the framework of IGAD, the Kenya government hosted the president of Kenya, Ethiopia, Djibouti, Uganda, all the countries hosting this population, and they have concluded that they will tolerate the situation of the Somali refugees in as long as the conditions inside the country is not ripe for massive return. But in the meantime, those who wish to return back to the country, because it's an active, as we speak now, voluntary return of the Somalis. And over the last 1.5 years, nearly over 100,000 Somalis have returned back into the country. Some, as we speak today, are registering, but others who feel they have threats to their life are still in the camps and receiving the attention of the government. Okay. And therefore, I think I would like to say that situation has turned into finding a solution. One of the solutions that we identified was to find quality education for refugees, Somali refugees. And we hosted a meeting in Djibouti under the framework of IGAD, what the leaders agreed in Nairobi. Thematic discussion on how do we focus on education. And now we have a blueprint on how can we be able to give quality education to Somali refugees, not only in Kenya, but in the sub-region. So when they return as people who are skilled. That, of course, requires resources, and we are seeking the support of the international community to assist the host countries like Kenya to cope up with this kind of challenges. So we are on the right track, and I think that we just need to see how best we can help the Somali government stabilize the country, the international community help the government there stabilize the country, so people return back to their home. As you will know, nobody wants to become a refugee forever. 27 years is a long period of time.
A very long period of time. And I must say a lot is banked on the stability in Somalia. But kindly brief us about the latest initiatives by the UNHCR to come up with refugee villages as opposed to camps, and as well as to foster integration, not just in terms of education, in the camps as we speak right now, regarding the refugee population, which is quite a number.
You know, first of all, we would like to thank all these countries hosting refugees, and particularly the Somali refugees, for this long period of time. And there is a new way of providing protection and support to refugees under the framework of CRRF. Mm-hmm. CRRF is Comprehensive refugee response framework. It's been agreed upon by all the leaders in New York September last year. Kenya is a pilot country, and Uganda is also a pilot country. Djibouti is a pilot country. Ethiopia is a pilot country. In Djibouti, the leaders there have decided now they no longer need camps. They have now transcended from camps to villages. Yes. In Uganda, we have settlements, very much like villages. And in Kenya, we are hoping that the government can take that kind of approach, because what this does is it helps through the movement of refugees, it helps the inclusion of refugees in the national programs, because essentially refugees are assets, they are not liabilities. They contribute to the economies of the region where they reside, as we have seen in Kakuma, for instance, where a research was done, 40% of the economy there is a contribution as a result of the contribution of the refugee, including the host community transactions, in the DAB the same way. So I think there is greater benefit for the countries in the sub-region to move away from camps and allow refugees access to job markets, allow refugees to do trade and investments in the country, and in particular the areas that is the host communities. So Kenya government is hopefully moving in that direction, and we have in the Turkana region, we have the Kaliobe settlement now, which is a pilot settlement to see how the host community and the refugee can coexist, collaborate, and live together. And therefore, we have realized that when that effort is done, a lot more benefit comes to the host communities. Because as you know, the host communities around the world and everywhere, including Kenya, these are the frontline ambassadors of those countries. Mm-hmm. The refugees relate to those host communities. If the host communities are happy, the refugees will be happy. If the host communities are not happy, certainly the refugees will have difficulty to stay there. So there's greater need, and we are appealing as UNHCR to the international community to assist those countries like Kenya, Ethiopia, Djibouti, Uganda, countries that are hosting large number of refugees, to assist them to offset the challenges that come with hosting such a large number, particularly for a long period of time, because we know that it involves resources. And we are certainly aware, apart from the generosity of the countries that are hosting, they also require to be supported with the resources to cope with the challenges coming with a large number of refugees, particularly those ones who stay for a long period of time, like the ones we have for the Dadaab and in Kakuma.
Okay. Over 27 years is not a short time, as you just mentioned. Absolutely. Thank you so much for making time, Ambassador Mohamed Abdi Afe. He's a special envoy for the Somali refugee situation under the UNHCR. We're talking about the latest report released by UNHCR on the education of children in various camps, not just Kakuma. Thank you so much for making time. We're glad you could join us on Bottom Line Africa. Okay, let's take a short break right now on Bottom Line Africa. We'll be back with more information for you on matters touching on the African continent. Do stay with us.